Well, good morning, everybody. Monday morning, the beginning of the week. And today we're going to have the reading about the rich young ruler, which might be familiar to you. It's certainly familiar to me. And I was wondering what newness I could get from this reading. And to my, well, not to my surprise, but as God's word does work, I found it a very deeply moving reading. So I worship at Barrick and welcome you all to this morning's reflection. The reading is taken from Matthew 19, beginning at verses 16. And behold, a man came up to him, saying, "Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?" And he said to him, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you would enter life, keep the commandments." He said to him, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." The young man said to him, "All these I have kept. What do I still lack?" Jesus said to him, "If you would be perfect, go, sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come, follow me." When the young man heard this, he went away very sorrowful, for he had great possessions. I love making lists of things to be done at the beginning of a day or at the beginning of a week. And then I have great pleasure in ticking them all off as they are completed. There is a sense of frustration when one or another item couldn't be ticked off in a day, but great satisfaction and achievement when the whole list is complete. It occurred to me that it was a bit like this for the young man in our story today, and I discovered that what is a familiar story to me has a lot to teach me. Let's start with prayer before we reflect on this reading. Heavenly Father, thank you for the Bible, which is your word to us. May it come alive within us to teach and inspire and to guide us. Amen. There's an interesting verse, an inspiring verse in Ecclesiastes chapter 3. This is what it says. God has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into man's heart. Some Christians might interpret this as saying God has put a God-shaped space in one's heart. The story of the rich young man is found in Mark as well as in Luke and Matthew. The wording and questions are slightly different, probably because the different gospel writers were respecting different parts of the same conversation. Even so, in each gospel, the urgent question on the young man's mind is about eternal life. It's so urgent, in fact, that he is recorded in Mark's gospel as actually running to Jesus, then kneeling to ask the question, "Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?" It's humbling to think that the man runs to Jesus while Jesus is walking towards Jerusalem and his death so that eternal life might be possible for each of us. It seems that the nameless, wealthy young man is sincere in his question. He may well be a ruler of a synagogue, perhaps. I wonder how long he had to wait for Jesus to answer him that question. I wonder how long Jesus thought about his answer for this particular young man. It was typical in Jewish teaching to answer a question with a question, a bit frustrating for those of us who like straightforward information and facts. But it is an important technique in helping the questioner to think more deeply about what they're really asking. Jesus asks, "Why do you ask me what is good? If you would enter life, keep the commandments." The anxious young man perhaps is wondering which commandment on his tick list he has not kept. After all, he knew them well, judging by his reply, after Jesus gives a representative list of 8 laws. "All these I have kept," he replied. It's bewildering to recall that apart from the 10 commandments on his, which were on this list, there are over 600 laws recorded to keep as well in the Torah. 600 more laws. Who could possibly keep them all? "All these I have kept," replied the serious young man. "What do I still lack?" I noticed in Mark's account that before he replied, Jesus looked at him and loved him. He loved him for his misplaced zeal altogether and misunderstanding. The young man knew that something was missing despite his efforts to fill that God-shaped space in his heart, that longing for eternal life, life in all its fullness. I'm reminded of a recent article in the Church Times about spirituality today in the lives of many young adults. There seems to be, and I quote, "a reimagining of religion as a more individualized, more institutional religion of the self, where people want to mix and match and play around with different traditions, different belief systems and practices. A sort of religious hybrid is emerging." Well, perhaps, in my opinion, these young generations in their faith journeys also feel something more is needed in their lives, and they are, like the young man, restless until they find an answer. I can just picture Jesus looking at these young adults and loving them as they research and ask questions about faith and life. Jesus' reply to the rich young ruler comes to the crux of the matter as he instructs him to sell all he has, giving the resulting money to the poor and to follow him. The lesson for the young man and for us is that eternal life isn't gained by ticking boxes or following rules to the letter. Eternal life is a gift. It doesn't come as a prize for ticking all those boxes and the commandments of the law, even though they are morally good in themselves. Where does the rich young ruler's love really lie? Jesus pushes him to go deeper, to know God in a personal way, not a legalistic one. The Message is a paraphrased version of the Bible, and the sadness of the young ruler is described like this. "And so, crestfallen, he walked away. He was holding on tight to a lot of things, and he couldn't bear to let go. He had great possessions, yes. He had no doubt given a percentage to the poor as was asked for in the law. But was he willing to put his possessions and his security at God's disposal? His possessions in the end were more important to him than his quest to inherit eternal life. We can ask ourselves, what am I holding on to? What's preventing me from following Jesus and resting in his grace and his loving provision. I close before a prayer with some words from Augustine of Hippo. Lord, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in you. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for your living and dying, that we might know eternal life, life in all its fullness. Help us to love you more and more. Amen. Every blessing for the week ahead.